All right, everyone. Good afternoon. I see in the chat that some of you come straight from another class. Yeah.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Okay. So let's start lightly then, and that'll give you some time to recover. I want to talk today about causality and the Kramers-Kronig relations. Let's see, but before, why is this not working? Yeah, so the program for today is to get you warmed up a little bit or cool down, respectively, a few questions. Then I'm going to introduce this concept of causality, have a brief recap of electromagnetic wave properties. You probably are very familiar with that, so that's not, but just for completeness. Then I want to derive the Kramers-Kronig relations. That's going to be a mathematical exercise. And after that, I have a few exercises and examples about that. So just up front, so causality, as we will see, dictates that the real and imaginary part of a physical response function are related. And this relation is then expressed in these so-called Kramers-Kronig equations, or Kramers-Kronig relations. We can derive these Kramers-Kronig relations for a refractive index, so what we're interested in optically, under the assumption of a weak interaction of light with materials. Well, that is an assumption that we are making throughout, so that is not going to hurt us here. And we'll see that the imaginary part of the refractive index is related to the absorption coefficient. So in the end, we'll have a Kramers-Kronig relation, a Kramers-Kronig expression that that basically expresses the real part of the refractive index, or the refractive index as we casually call it, as a function of the absorption coefficient. So to start you off, here are a few questions about Raman. My proposal is, as always, please discuss among yourself, either in the chat or else, and if there are questions or anything needs to be clarified, then I'm here.
So I like summarized lecture one a bit earlier last week. So I do know this from the, what are they called? The Jablonski diagrams. So for Raman or Stokes scattering, you have energy loss. For anti-Stokes Raman, that's the upscattering. So energy, the photon gains energy. This, I think.
Yeah, that is correct. Do you also know what's the consequence of that for the wavelength of the emitted photon?
Right, so higher energy photons have a shorter wavelength. So if the photon gains energy, the wavelength is shortened. So anti-Stokes has shorter wavelength and Stokes has longer wavelength.
Yeah, that's correct. That's perfectly fine. Anything to add by anyone? It's not there. No, that's exactly what it is. Does anyone know which process is more likely to occur? Because if you look at the equations on the slides, then you see an equation which has both the Stokes and the anti-Stokes term. So which one is more likely? Pepijn says Stokes. Can you explain why?
Hi. Sorry, I'm following two lectures at the same time, so it's a bit of a...
you should never admit that.
No, I know, but I'm good at split braining, I guess. It's more likely because the energy is in a ground state, and that's more probability due to the Boltzmann probability distribution.
Yeah, exactly. So okay. Okay.
Good job on giving the right answer while following two lectures.
Yeah, that's pretty impressive. Just out of curiosity, which is the other lecture?
Current clinical issues from a BMTP, biomedical technology and physics.
Oh, okay.
Because I'm still deciding on one of the other. So.
Ah, okay.
Yeah, but it's 80% overlap. So yeah. I mean courses, not lectures. By the way.
otherwise, I would be very disappointed.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay. Well, good luck with that.
No problem.
I hope you can keep up today.
Yeah, sure.
I'll test you along the way. Okay, can somebody give me a number or an interpretation for a Raman efficiency? How would you define a Raman efficiency?
Yeah, so I'm like quickly looking through my notes. It's in lecture 5 somewhere. Johannes talked about it. But I'm having a bit of a hard time finding exactly.
Okay, but in the meantime, Sharon says, is it simply the Raman power divided by the initial power? Yeah, that's how I would define it. So we had this absorption and scattering efficiencies, which were just the ratio of absorbed power or scattered power over incident power. So we can do the same thing for Raman. We can just define the amount of power that is Raman scattered divided by the by the input power. Yeah, so that's what I mean with the Q Raman. And now the question is, can we put a number on it, or an order of magnitude? That is doesn't have to be an exact number, of course. Yeah, a lot less. That could be that. That, funnily enough, I don't know that number. it's not so loosely related. Actually, that's question 3. So if I remember, so yeah, exactly. About 10 to the minus 6 or to 10 to the minus 8, that order of magnitude. So very, very, very small. So the probability of this happening is just simply very, very low. Pepijn already mentioned the cross section. That's then question 3. So if you know this efficiency, how can you translate that into a Raman scattering cross section and a Raman scattering coefficient? Yeah, so Jorgen, what is G in your equation? So you say sigma Raman is cross-section, Raman is G times...
G is the geometrical cross-section of the...
Yeah, exactly. So, yeah. So you have to find that for the molecule, but indeed. Yeah, and then to the coefficient, to the Raman scattering coefficient. Yeah, times the number density. If you scale it with the number density of the particles, and then you know the. Yeah, so it's exactly the same as for the absorption coefficient and for the elastic scattering coefficient that we defined before. You can just use the same mechanism to describe it. And then along that same reasoning is then the fourth question. So let's say I give you an expression that the expected free path length for Raman scattering is given by 1 over the mu Raman, 1 over the Raman scattering cross section, is in the order of 1 kilometer. So how would you interpret, how can we interpret such a statement?
So it's Sigma Raman is in the orders of 1 kilometer?
No, the left hand side, so L, the expectation. the Raman length is in the order of 1 kilometer. Yeah, Mike has the right answer. So on average, so the expected value of the length that the photons travel without having a Raman scattering happening is 1 kilometer. Just like 1 over mu s was the expectation value of a path length without elastic scattering and etc. So that interpretation too is analogous. And of course, if the efficiency is this low, the process doesn't happen much. So on average, a photon can travel 1 kilometer before that happening. Okay, then slightly trickier one. What is CARS? So Johannes mentioned a few exotic variations of Raman spectroscopy. CARS was one of them. Can you explain the mechanism of CARS? Do you remember what CARS was?
Okay, so it had something to do with 2 pumps, I think. You have a laser pump and the one that's actually producing the Stokes signal. And they somehow interacted, I think, to get a anti-Stokes signal, right? At a frequency of 2 times.
Yeah, right. Since one of the lasers puts the electrons from the ground state in a slightly higher state to a slightly higher vibrational state, and therefore it's easier to achieve the like anti-Stokes Raman scattering, which promotes the mu Raman, right?
Yeah. So the acronym stands for coherent anti-Stokes Raman scattering. Yeah, yeah. So conceptually you need 3 laser beams. So the first and the second are matched. So the energy difference of energy difference of the first and the second are matched to a vibrational level.
Yeah.
So if you excite the molecule with one laser and coherently with the other one, so everything is neatly in phase, then you promote basically filling of that vibrational level. So you kind of stimulated filling of the vibrational level, and then with a third laser beam, you can do your let's say conventional anti-Stokes Raman scattering. So probe that energy level, and then from a practical point of view, you can pick the first and the third laser to be the same. That doesn't matter. So then you can do it with 2. Exactly. Two. So first you pump the molecule so that the higher vibrational level gets populated, and then with that same laser you can probe that level on with an anti-Stokes signal. So you can greatly enhance the anti-Stokes signal.
Yeah. Also the contrast, right?
Excuse me. I'm sorry, I didn't get that.
The contrast on the image is also greatly enhanced, right? Because you have more signal.
Yeah, of course. But can you think of another benefit of doing it this way? Because it is mightily complicated. So why would you be so interested in the anti-Stokes signal? The spectra are symmetrical.
I mean, isn't contrast kind of a generally quite important for making medical images, since like a higher contrast allows you to see more details?
Yeah, of course, but you're now course. Let me rephrase the question a little bit. If you, let's say, you could do some kind of trick in order to amplify the Stokes signal. So now we're amplifying the anti-Stokes signal. Let's say you could do the trick, the same trick, maybe simpler even, to amplify the Stokes signal. What could still be a reason to prefer this CARS approach?
Maybe less fluorescence.
Yeah, that's Can you elaborate a little bit on that?
I don't know exactly how it works, but you don't want a fluorescent signal because you only want to see the Raman peaks, and the fluorescence like a mountain where the peaks are on top. So if you can enhance the peaks, then you see more results.
Yeah.
You can better analyze it.
Yeah. So if you look at the mechanism of fluorescence and of Stokes Raman scattering, these are both processes where there is energy lost to the molecule, so you get longer wavelengths in both cases. So the Stokes Raman spectrum and the fluorescence spectra, they overlap, and the efficiency of fluorescence is much higher than of Raman. So this Raman was 10 to the power 6 or 8. And for fluorescence, it's, I don't know, 1 in 1,000 or something. Mm-hmm. And so you have this huge background of fluorescence with this tiny, tiny little bit of Raman on top of it. So you have to do a lot of filtering and processing, et cetera, to filter out this Raman spectrum. If you use the anti-Stokes, the fluorescence still gives longer wavelengths, but the anti-Stokes gives shorter wavelengths. So you neatly separate the, you can neatly separate these two processes. So that's where the real sensitivity comes from. And that's why it is still so interesting. Well,
additional question. I can reckon that it's also a bit faster than normal anti-Stokes Raman, right? Like, to acquire images.
Because you have more signal, you can you don't need to integrate so long. Yeah,
that's
definitely true. That's definitely true.
Yeah,
yeah. So normally you would have to. I don't know. I don't know the exact measurement times, but this allows you to speed things up.
Hmm.
People are. Talking about Raman imaging already, so that looks promising there. Okay, I have something as a practical application. Hemozoin is a hemoglobin breakdown product that is produced by the malaria parasite. So that takes up hemoglobin, the protein that transports oxygen, and produces a breakdown product called hemozoin. That is that hemozoin is Raman active. It has Raman peaks. So detecting hemozoin using Raman spectroscopy has been proposed, therefore, for fast or accurate diagnosis of malaria. So my question is for you: it has a Raman peak at 1371 per centimeter. Can you now calculate for me the emission wavelength, the Raman emission wavelength in nanometers? If we use a 780 nanometer excitation wavelength. Is that I'm Marloes, Pepijn?
Oh, you hear that? Shit.
Yeah, it is. Can you briefly explain, Maaike?
Yes, so the formula for calculating the Raman peak, so that's an energy difference, is 1 over the excitation wavelength minus 1 over the emission wavelength times 10 to the 7th to account for the difference in units. So if you rewrite that, then you can calculate the emission wavelength, and that's the calculation I put in the chat.
Yeah, that's exactly right. Yeah, so and then you end up with also with an emission wavelength that is larger than the excitation wavelength, just as you expect.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, is that clear to everyone? I guess so, right? This is formalizing the slides as well. So, okay, then a few more questions about OCT. So, same thing. Yeah, non-monochromatic, like white light. So that means it is a light source that has more than one wavelength in it. White light would be a very broad wavelength range. You can also have a more narrower bandwidth, let's say 100 nanometers or something. So that's what we call a low coherence light source. In addition to in opposition to a high coherence light source, so that would be a laser with only one single wavelength, a very narrow wavelength. All right, that's correct. Can anyone explain briefly the difference between time domain OCT and spectral domain OCT? Yeah, time domain is where that's correct. Where the reference arm is moved as a function of time. Basically, that's where the name comes from. Okay, and how does that contrast with spectral domain OCT? Any additions to that? It's true. So one big difference, of course, is that the reference arm, in the case of spectral domain OCT, the reference arm is not moving. It is just stationary. And the price you pay for that is that you have to use a more complicated detector. So you can, instead of using a simple detector that measures the signal for every position of the mirror, you now have a spectrometer. So that broadband light from that low coherence light source, so all these wavelengths, are split using a grating, and each wavelength is detected by a pixel of a spectrometer. So what you now detect is an interference spectrum. If the spectrometer is fast enough, if you can read it fast enough, then it's then it can be really fast. But you then need to do a Fourier transform to get the data for the image again, to get the same as what you would measure using time domain. One of the obvious benefits of that is that you don't have a moving mirror anymore, so no moving parts. So the system is much more stable. You can actually use it in the clinic quite easily, and also it's faster because these spectrometers can be built very fast. Is there another advantage? It's a little bit related to that speed. It's more sensitive. I don't know if Johannes showed this example where if you have a time domain system with only one detector, if you change that system a little bit and use, instead of one, use like, for example, four detectors, then what you basically do is split the noise over four detectors. And then you can filter a little bit more for each detector, and it becomes more sensitive. Now with the spectrometer, which can have 1,000 or 2,000 pixels, you basically have 2,000 detectors lined side by side. So you split the signal over these detectors, but you also split the noise over these detectors, and that allows you to filter more, to do more filtering. So your sensitivity for spectral domain OCT is much higher, and that's great, of course. But if you're still slow, then it doesn't really help you. But the good thing is now that you can image at the same speed as you would for time domain OCT, but with a much higher sensitivity. So that you can, and then you can balance that trade-off a little bit if you want to. If you want to image faster, then you can, and then maybe you lose some sensitivity again. But it is much more sensitive. So that is also a main advantage. And therefore, it's also now the common way of doing OCT. A little bit related to that, can somebody describe to me what we mean with shot noise limited detection? Do you remember what shot noise is?
That's just random noise generated by the Poisson distribution of photons. I do remember Johannes using a graph with three separate domains. And yeah, that the ideal position was in the shot noise domain, as the graph was quickly increasing in the third domain, where you don't no longer have the relationship that the signal to noise ratio is the square root of intensity,
there it's squared. That's true. Yeah, so the shot noise is that's the fundamental lower limit that you cannot beat. That is just the fluctuation in arrival time of the photons, so just statistical noise basically. that that is always there. So that you cannot beat. If you would have an ideal laser, then you would only have this shot noise. But for this low coherence light sources, because they have multiple wavelengths, that means, yeah, but it's a little bit of a complicated story, but it means that that the laser itself, the cavity supports these multiple wavelengths, and that means it has a finite number of thermal modes, and that translates into an extra noise term called this relative intensity noise. And so that is always that's a property of these low coherence light sources. That is also something you cannot beat, but we do know that it scales with the output power, with the output intensity. So if you can reduce that as much as possible, not too much, but too much as possible, then you can slide into this regime where the noise is dominated by shot noise and not by this intensity noise. So that means that that's indeed that graph that you refer to. If you have high output power, then you have more intensity noise than shot noise. So then you get this steep slope. If you decrease the power, if you can manage to decrease the power, then you slide into the other regime where you have where you're limited by the shot noise. So that is then indeed the best you can do. Okay. Then let's talk about imaging. So you make an image. How is the depth resolution, the axial on the axis of the, that you're looking at? What determines the axial or the depth resolution of an OCT system? Yeah, Sharon, you're right. The coherence length. Yeah. So, can you briefly explain what is, so you say coherence length and I see FWHM there. Can you briefly elaborate on that?
Yeah, so I think that maybe the full width helped max of your the intensity of your wavelength of the laser, maybe.
Yeah, so that so the full width half max. So you need a spectrum which has more than one wavelength. So let's say it's a Gaussian spectrum around some central wavelength. Then the width, the full width at half maximum. So. Of that Gaussian determines how many wavelengths you have. So a large full width half maximum means a lot, a broad emission band of the laser. So that's true. But how does that relate to the coherence length?
So the coherence length was defined as the full width half max. So the broader your spectrum of wavelength, then the larger your coherence length is?
Not quite. Almost.
Yeah, it does not really make sense to me that if I would have a broader spectrum, that I would then have a better resolution. But yeah, in my notes, I wrote that the resolution is depending on the full width half max. And so therefore, I thought maybe it was like this.
Yeah. Okay. Then I see where the confusion comes from, because you can the problem with full width half max is that you can define it into two different domains. You can if you look at so you remember this this OCT signal from a mirror, which was like a very narrow interference signal over just a small part of the scan. Yeah. So if you would draw a Gaussian envelope around that interference signal, then the full width half max of that envelope would be the resolution, because that would be the response to a mirror, which would be a kind of a delta impulse to the whole OCT system, and the full width half max of that would would then be the resolution. So in the full width half max in the spatial domain is the resolution. That is correct. But it relates. So how do you, and Pepijn says inverse, and that is correct. So if you have a broad wavelength spectrum, then you get a very narrow peak in the OCT signal. So the broader the larger the full width half max of the spectrum, the narrower the full width half max of the peak becomes, and the better the resolution becomes. So the actual then we have to be precise as well. So the actual resolution in the image domain, let's say that inversely scales with the full width half max of the spectrum of the laser. But the broader the spectrum, the narrower the peak. And then the resolution in the other plane, so the plane perpendicular to the to depth. That's true. So that just depends on the optics that you're using. How narrow can you focus the beam on the thing that you want to measure? So that is solely determined by the optics that you use. And that's the big difference with confocal microscopy. If you have a normal confocal microscope, then both the depth resolution and the lateral, so the resolution in plane, are determined by the optics. So everything is determined by the optics there. Whereas in OCT, these two are decoupled. So you can have a lens with a relatively weak lateral resolution and still have a very high axial resolution because of the parameters of your light source. So that is decoupled then. Yeah, that's correct. Then last question. Let's say we have two OCT systems that are equally performing. The only difference is that one has a wavelength of 800 nanometers, center wavelength, and the other one has a center wavelength of 1300 nanometers. Which can you argue which system you would use to image the retina, so netflix, and which system would you use, for example, to image skin? So for argument's sake, let's say that they have the same resolutions and also the same sensitivities.
Then wouldn't you use the longer wavelength to image the skin, since scattering is less likely to occur at longer wavelengths?
Yeah, that's a good argument to do it that way. Yeah. Is there okay? So, and for the retina, then you could pick the same system there, or would you there go for the 800 nanometer?
Because in the eye, I think you have a lot more to do with fluid, water. So I'm guessing that 800 nanometers is a better wavelength to use due to absorption properties of water, but I'm not sure about that.
No, that's exactly correct. If you want to image the retina, you have to go to a few centimeters of water in your eye first. And the absorption at 1300 nanometer is just higher, so you lose more. And you have to pass that twice, going in and going out, so you lose a lot of light through absorption. So then 800 is a better choice for that. That's exactly true. All right.
I have a question.
Yes, go ahead.
If we lose the restriction on the resolution, you could argue that the 800 nanometer OCT light has a better actual resolution, right? So it's better suited for fine details like the eye.
So the resolution is the resolution was determined by by your light source. So the the formula for the coherence length, I'm not sure if you remember, it was something like 2 times ln2 over pi, that's just a constant, times then the center wavelength squared divided by the bandwidth. So if you have that means that for 800 nanometers, which is a relatively low center wavelength, you can have let's say a bandwidth of 100 nanometers, then you get an actual resolution of approximately 3 microns, something like that, 3 micrometer. If you want to have that same resolution using the 1300 nanometer system, you have to have a much larger bandwidth.
Yeah.
Quadratically. and that is so that's then yeah at a certain point that's just not possible anymore. These things do not exist. So in practice it is easier to get this high resolution with lower wavelength systems, because then you need So in theory you could do it, but then you would need at a certain point you would need a huge bandwidth, and that is just technically not possible or not existent.
Okay, thanks.
All right. Okay, let's have a break. Let's continue at 14:40. Yep.